Kanka
Thanks a lot. I hope everyone can hear me. This is a huge auditorium. I actually took Physics 101, or I think it was called 105, from Mehmet Tomak in this auditorium. I also took Calculus, so it brings me a lot of memories back to me. But this is, today it's going to be a very hard talk. It's always very hard to talk about other people's work. Especially when these other people are so much better than you, it's harder to talk about. But today's this year's Nobel Prize is very close to my research. That's why I think the good people of the department and the physics society invited me to give an overview of 2016 Nobel Prize. So let's talk about Swedish Academy of Sciences. This year they said we're going to give the prize, half of the prize, to David Tallas. The other half jointly to Duncan Halding and Michael Kosterits. All these three guys are theorists, theoretical physicists, which is a rarity. Actually, most Nobel Prizes go to experimentalists. So theoretical Nobel Prizes are more rare. You should know this. For theoretical discoveries of topological phase transitions and topological phases of matter. So this is a bunch of multiple words, big words, topological phase, phase transition. So my aim today is to give you a feeling, not an understanding, certainly not any detail of what these three men and their collaborators accomplished over the years. And why topology is important in physics. I can't hear. There is a comment. Okay, so good. Now, let's see. What's topology? Right. Topology, I looked up the dictionary. I thought I knew what it was, but in the dictionary there was a very good definition, so I decided to include it. It's a branch of geometry which studies properties which do not change with continuous changes in size or shape. Let's try to understand what that means. And we actually, it's one of the rare branches of mathematics where we have an intuitive understanding of what's going on. If I take two strings, two loops of string, and link them together, even a three-year-old child knows that however I bend these strings, if they are rubber bands, however I pull them, unless I cut one of the strings, I will never take them apart. Right? So, going from link, two link loops to two separate loops requires cutting of at least one loop. It takes a little bit of more imagination to see that you can't go from loops which are linked once to twice. No matter how you try to put a knot in there, unlike you stretch one of your strings, you can never put two knots, two links. So this object here and this object here cannot be transformed to each other without cutting. So topology basically assigns classes to geometric shapes which are equivalent to each other under continuous changes. Okay. So with just string loops, this is easy to imagine. It gets a little bit harder in higher dimensions. So here is my algebraic formula for a sphere. From real space onto a space of vectors, mx, my, mz is my order parameter space. And it's a continuous mapping. So if I actually move along a closed path in real space, there is an image of that loop in my order parameter space. And once I start talking about this language, I can classify topological objects, topological defects, in any order parameter. Just a simple example, and it turns out mathematicians have been up to the task many years before physicists. There is a branch of topology called homotopy theory, which really classifies what kind of defects you can have in any manifold. Just a simple example. In the previous case, we have talked about a plane, and I put a vertex in there. That was like a hole, the central point, all spins are looking ahead, away from. So if I take a loop around that hole, I can write a phase 2 part, and no matter how I deform the loop, without crossing the central point, I cannot shrink it to a zero. Okay. The loop is there. It's not equivalent to just a point. What happens if I try to put a vertex onto a magnet, not on a plane, but living in a sphere? So you can say, okay, let me put one hole in my sphere, and one wider phase, this angle 2 pi around it. Isn't this a topological excitation? And I'll say, no, it's not. Because think of this loop as a rubber band. I can make it larger and larger, go around the sphere, and in the other side, I can shrink it just to a point. So the vertex you're going to create on a plane is a topological object. It's going to live for a long time. On a sphere, vertex, if you locally try to create a vertex, it's not going to be a topological object. It will go away easily to have less lifetime. Now, these have been very abstract examples. Do people actually see topological excitations in the lab? And the answer is yes. The simplest experiment you can do is take a superconductor and put it in a magnetic field. Now, superconductors have this fantastic property that they exclude magnetic field. They don't want magnetic field inside them. But if you actually force the point, you put in more and more magnetic field. At some point, magnetic field starts going into the superconductor in basically a tube. They form tubes that are passing through the superconductor. And these are exactly the vertices, exactly equal to the vertices I've been talking about. Because in a superconductor, order parameter is not a vector at each point. It's a complex number at each space point. You have to learn graduate quantum mechanics to see why, but once you accept my word for it, that it's a complex number at each point, then it's easy to understand. I can actually take a, if you want, a tube going through my superconductor. And this theta can be wound around my tube by 2 pi. That would make it very stable topological object. And here is the nice thing, and that comes from quantum mechanics. The magnetic flux, which is sort of the number of field lines passing through this tube, is exactly H over E, where H is times constant E is electron charge. That's fantastic. That's called flux quantum. So each of my vertices is now a quantum object carrying definite amount of flux through it. Now, I said these objects are very stable. How stable are they? The record for keeping a vertex in a superconductor is more than 2 years. So someone actually put in a vertex there, 2 years later they came and checked, it was still there. But you need to cool, superconductors need cooling, you need to keep them in the very cold refrigerator. So after 2 years they basically closed the refrigerator, it's vertex factory. But the theoretical calculation is that if you have a good sized superconductor, a vertex inside that can live longer than the age of the universe. It's not going to go out. Yes? I remove the external magnetic field, the vertex just stays there. Now, that's the simplest topological defect. Have people seen more interesting topological defects? This is an experimental picture. What happens if you increase the magnetic field? You may say maybe more magnetic field will go through this tube. It doesn't happen. Once you fill up this one flux quantum, you put it in another tube. You put it in a third tube, fourth tube, and such tube form a lattice, a triangular lattice of vertices. That's called the vertex lattice. This picture is an experimental picture of order parameter, if you want, the density, showing 250 vertices inside a Bose-Einstein condensate. You can have even stranger things. In a magnet, you can think of a situation where I take a point in space and all my vectors are pointing away from it. That is called a hedgehog, which is cheating in Turkish. It's a good name for an excitation. It's hard to create this object, but if you create it in a magnet, it actually doesn't decay easily. Keeps there for a long time. And just this year, in 2016, there was a paper in Nature Physics. They said they actually formed a Hopf vibration in a Bose-Einstein condensate. I've been working on this field for the last 10, maybe 8 years. I have never heard about Hopf vibration before this paper. But it's such a complex, knotted object that they need at least two coordinate frames to tell us what it is. Nonetheless, they were able to engineer this very complex topological object in the laboratory and then looked at how it decays. Now, you may think, okay, these are good, these are exciting things, but they are sort of like, they belong in a zoo. Okay. They are like an elephant. You go to the zoo, you look at the elephant, you say, oh, okay, you know, topology. Very interesting, and then when you're walking down the street, you don't worry about elephants. Let me tell you how topology can be useful. But first, let me give you a reminder. Maybe there are some freshmen here who hasn't really taken physics 106 yet, electromagnetism. But from high school, you know that if I have an electric charge, all electric field lines go away from it. But if I have a magnet, field lines do not stop. They actually form complete loops. There is a north pole and south pole, but they form complete loops. Can I get an object a magnetic charge? If I try to split this magnet into two, I'll basically get two more dipole magnets. I will never get an object which is called a monopole. Okay, so it's like a magnetic charge. That has never been observed in lab. But let me remind you of another fact. Charge, electric charge in nature comes as an integer multiple of electron charge. You can have 1e charge, 2e charge, you can never have 1/5 of electron charge. So it's a quantized property. Now, with this background information, let me give you the first topological argument in quantum mechanics. Right after quantum mechanics was founded, Dirac gave this argument. And what he did is, he imagined an electron living in a sphere with a magnetic monopole at its center. So the electron seems like a hedgehog of bee pairs in this sphere, but it's constrained to live on the surface. And he proved something that's remarkable. He said, for quantum mechanics to be consistent, if a monopole exists, electric charge must be quantized. Let's be very careful. He did not actually prove the reverse. He did not prove that electric charge is quantized, magnetic monopole exists. But still, that's wonderful. That's the first time anyone actually proposed a reason as to why electric charge should be quantized. So maybe this quantization of electric charge has something to do with topology. People have looked for magnetic monopoles everywhere. I mean everywhere. In deep mines, in seawater, in soil coming from the moon. And there are two satellites looking for magnetic monopoles in orbit. And nobody has seen them. But still, topology, you can see, is a very persuasive argument. It's so persuasive, it may actually launch satellites into orbit. So topology is important, it's useful. But how does one create these things? One is, as I showed, you put in magnetic field, you rotate the superfluid, you design the system, basically. You explicitly, deliberately put in a topological excitation. That's like putting an elephant into the zoo. Okay, then people come and look at it and say, wow, topological excitation, how nice. Another way is to start from a state which does not have order and very quickly cool it to an ordered state. So if you take a magnet, if you take a piece of iron, and if you start with a non-magnetized state and cool it very fast, what you will see is that different parts of the system will not have time to exchange information. So you will form domains, different domains of magnetization, which at their edges will form different topological defects in time. What I find interesting is this is called the Kibble-Zurek mechanism. It was not discussed for magnets or for superfluids or for other things. It was first dreamed of for the universe. Kibble and Zurek were very concerned that after the Big Bang, there wasn't enough time for different parts of the universe to equilibrate. So they thought there would be domain rules and cosmic strings that go through the universe. I don't know if they really are there, but still I find this interesting. But for a very long time, I mean, until 1930s to 1970s, people really thought these topological arguments belonged in the zoo. They were not in real life. They said spontaneous topological excitation does not happen. Why does it not happen? Because to put in the topological excitation, I need to change the system globally. I need to change all the parts of the system to create a vertex at the center. But in the 1970s, there was a sort of a crisis in statistical mechanics. If you take a three-dimensional magnet, it has a disordered phase, a paramagnetic phase, and a magnetic phase. If you look at two pieces which are separated by a distance r, in the non-magnetic phase, the memory of the direction decays exponentially. And maybe you know from your RC circuits that exponential decay basically means the thing goes to zero after a few time constants. Here it's called coherence length. So this has very short memory, that's non-magnetized. But in the magnetized state, the memory is basically infinite. Even the two edges of the system know which direction they are pointing about. So you did this theory, there's a phase transition between them. In theory, you could calculate what's the critical temperature. You go to the experimentalist, they do the experiment, it agrees perfectly. So people were very happy. They said, Landau, Ginzburg, and Wilson solve the problem of phase transitions. We can calculate everything. Then you take this approach of Landa, Ginzburg, and Wilson and apply it to a seemingly simpler model, a two-dimensional magnet. So basically, a flat magnet, okay, and all my spins cannot look out of the plane, they must remain in the plane. That's why it's also called an XY magnet. And now, if you actually do Ginzburg, Leon, Landa, Wilson theory, you find that, well, it never, the memory of the direction decays as a power law, 1 over r to the alpha. That's actually much slower than an exponential decay. And more troubling is that you actually never see a phase transition. So theory said there is no front phase transition. Experimentalists went to the internet. They did the experiment, they saw the phase transition. Physics is an experimental science. Okay. If correctly done experiments tell you something, you should look for the reason. And that's what Kostaris and Talmas did. They said, hey, okay, if I want to create a single vertex, that's very hard. I need to orient all my magnets away from it, even at the edges of the system. But instead of creating one vertex, if I create a vertex rotating one way and an anti-vertex which is rotating in the other way, here, I only have to orient the magnets basically between them. If I take a vertex dipole at far away, its effects are negligible. So I can create such objects, a plus vertex rotating one way, and a minus vertex rotating the other way, if they are close to each other, they will not change the magnetization state far away. So I can create such objects with only local native modification. And with that insight, really, the calculation in the first paper is very simple. You can follow it once you learn your statistical mechanics and quantum theory. They have no actually understood what's going on in 2D magnets. They said, hey, at low temperature, such pairs arise, vertex, anti-vertex, but they quickly come back and annihilate each other. So it's like a hydrogen atom of electron and proton. Okay? They are a dipole, but they are bound together. If I increase the temperature, the weak gets the binding gets weaker and weaker. So electrons spend more time away from the proton, but it comes back. And at some point, the positive vertex and negative vertex are not bound any longer. This is exactly like the plasma transition. If I heat my hydrogen gas up, at some point electrons will be free of the protons. What I will get is a plasma. So at high T, there are free positive vertices, free negative vertices. So it's a plasma of vertices, and this nicely has an exponentially decaying memory. So there is a phase transition in 2D magnets. That is due to topological excitation. So this was the first topological phase transition that was identified. And it's called BKT transition. So here's the book cover written in 2013, 40 years of Berezinski, Kostaris, Talmas theory. Now, what did this phase transition do? It resolved the crisis about 2D magnets. It's applied not only to 2D magnets, it's applied to superfluid films, 2D melting, superconductors. More importantly, it showed that these topological excitations are not, you know, elephants in the zoo. They can basically run over you when you're walking in the street, so you should be careful. Topological excitations are things that should be taken seriously. So the first paper was written by Kostaris and Talmas. As I said, it's a simple paper outlining the idea. More detailed calculations were carried out by Kostaritz, and he fit the experimental data extremely well. I'm amazed that in the last 5 minutes, no one asked me who is Berezinski.
Okay.
Because it's called Berezinski-Kostaritz-Tauless transition. So here is Vadim Berezinski, the only picture of him I could find. He actually wrote two papers, 2 years and 1 year before Kostaritz and Tauless. He talked about the importance of vertices in 2D. He talked about this, what he called a vertex molecule of plus minus. He discussed how it will dissociate. He never talked about the phase transition. But what's really interesting, I know most of you maybe were born after internet, so you don't remember a time when internet was not in our lives. But in 1970s, papers actually had to be printed out and carried from Moscow to Birmingham, England, to be read by people in Birmingham. Right? So Kostaritz and Tauless didn't know about Berezinski's papers. And even if they got the paper, they didn't speak Russian. There is no internet, there is no Google Translate. So it took at least a few years for the papers to be translated. So Kostaritz and Tauless did this work independently. Now, does Berezinski deserve a piece of the Nobel Prize? Well, we will never get the answer, because Berezinski unfortunately died in 1980 at the age of 44. And dead men do not win Nobel Prizes. So if you want a Nobel Prize, the first thing you should do is stay alive. Okay. Now, how about experimental confirmation? Even right after the theory came out, it had very nice things that can be checked against the experiment. There is the so-called superfluid stiffness temperature dependence, and 5 different experiments fall under Kostaritz-Tauless line. So this is indirect evidence that Kostaritz-Tauless theory was working. But in 2006, people actually could look at the microscopic mechanism. They took a superfluid, both a gas, 2D gas, and increasing the temperature, they could see these vertex pairs dissociate. So even the microscopic mechanism behind Kostaritz-Tauless theory is now understood and experimentally verified to a great precision. Okay, that's very good. So, any excitation, what does statistical mechanics tell us? Statistical mechanics tell us everything has a probability to appear proportional to the Boltzmann factor, E to energy over kVt. So, creating a vertex anti-vertex pair does not cause that much energy. What it does is it actually creates more entropy, because you can actually place those things everywhere.
Right.
So at high temperatures, energy cost of these things are overcome by the entropy gain. That's why all these free vertices appear. It's basically entropy that drives the transition. Yes?
We are talking about the cold and the hot, but how cold or how hot?
Excellent question. Now, in physics, there is always a natural scale that determines the physical scale. For these ultra-cold atoms, for the experiment here, the transition temperature is 100 nanokelvin. It's very low. For the experiments here, there are 2D magnets and superfluid. The transition temperature is 10 kelvin. So it's 9 orders of magnitude different. For some models in relativistic physics I have seen, Kostaritz-Tauless transition temperature happens at MeV, millielectrons. That's much higher temperature. Okay, so the nature, the mechanism is written in terms of dimensionless variables. So the mechanism is the same whether you're doing it at nanokelvin, kelvin, or hundreds of kelvin. Okay, good question. Yes. coming from. But for me, going from a magnetized state to a non-magnetized state is a physical change. That doesn't change the, for example, stiffness of the solid. However, Costa's Tallis theory is applied to melting of two-dimensional materials like graphene. Melting of graphene is explained by Costa's Tallis theory, and that's much a, very much a physical change. It goes from a liquid to a solid. Any other questions? Okay. Let's move on. Let me tell you, I still have time. Let me quickly go through quantum Hall effect. Now, quantum Hall effect, I will not give you the details, but Hall experiment, you will probably, or you have already done it in the freshman lab. It's an easy experiment, perpendicular magnetic field. You run current one way, look at the voltage the other way. If you do it for a two-dimensional system, here's the interesting thing. You see that 1 over resistance becomes quantized with magnetic field, with high magnetic field. And it becomes quantized so well that the resistance of the first plateau divided by the second plateau is 2 with a precision of 7 digits. It's 2.000003 or something like that. That's one of the rare experiments where the experimenters were concerned why they were getting so good results. They were actually, why is our experiment so precise? They were bothered by it. The experiment was done in 1981 and got the Nobel Prize in 1985. It was so surprising. There's actually something defined as von Kritzin constant after the guy who did the experiment. And there's a guy called Laughlin who immediately linked this observation to topology. He thought of an electron moving on a band, and he showed that if I put an extra magnetic field through this loop, when I change this flux by one flux quantum, exactly one electron must move from the right edge to the left edge. It's a two-page paper, extremely well written, extremely easy to follow, and he showed that quantum Hall effect in its heart is a topological effect. And here's one idea, I mean, that's now prevalent. Everyone agrees that if something is topological, it's related to integers. If something is topological, it's well protected. These are not precise statements, this is just the feeling of physicists, okay? Now, here, where does Tallis come in? He did the following. Laughlin's argument was sort of deficient. He said, either electrons flow freely, so it's a gas of electrons, or electrons do not flow at all. Laughlin's argument. No, this is Tallis. So what happened is that Tallis actually considered the real solid. A real solid has a periodic potential. This is an STM image. And we understand solids very well. We understand them in momentum space, where actually the topology, it turns out, is not a square, but it's a torus. You wrap this square into a torus. And Tallis, with his students, calculated Hall conductivity. He found it to be an integer times e squared over h, universal constant. This is now called the TKNN formula. And it's the first time a physical observable is directly linked to a topological invariant in math. And it creates really wonderful physical objects. Here is the energy band diagram of an electron moving in a square lattice under a magnetic field. It's a fractal, depending on the Hofstadter butterfly that was realized before Tallis, 10 years before Tallis. But what Tallis showed is that each gap in the spectrum is a quantum Hall state, and he could calculate the integer associated with each gap. So he produced a map like this. Blue means minus 1, red means plus 1, deeper blue is 2, minus 2. It goes like that, it covers all the plane. Behind the nicety of all this, the important thing is that churn number, which is the topological mathematical object, is now intricately linked with Hall conductance. This is a physical measure. Now, one more thing Thales did. Do you know what this device is? This is called an Archimedes screw water pump. You put a screw onto a water, you get a slave to turn the crank, and the water will go from lower lake to your field for irrigation. It's been used for 2,000 years. So what Thales did is asked, if I change my potential adiabatically, can I pump electrons? And he actually found the formula for how much pumping there will be. It's again a topological formula, which gives you how many electrons pass through your system. And it's actually useful. People have built single electron pumps on the side. There's a device which can really reliably give you one electron when you push a button.
Okay.
And even in 2016, people did the same thing for atoms. So now we have pumps for single atoms. Now let's go to Horn-Langenberg. I've talked about Costalis, I've talked about Thales most of the time. What is this third guy, Haldane, did? Okay, basically, Haldane was reading papers, not in condensed matter physics at the time, although he's a condensed matter physicist. He was reading field theory papers from high energy, and high energy theorists had a problem. They had this thing called parity anomaly, and whenever they tried to write a lattice model which has parity anomaly, they ended up with two kinds of objects, two kinds of electrons. That was called Fermi model. And Haldane said, hey, let me think around a little bit. He said, if I take a lattice where electrons jump from not only to nearest neighbors, but next nearest neighbors, I can give you a model which has parity anomaly, which does not have fermion doubling. So that's what the paper says. But he also quickly realized you can see quantum Hall effect without magnetic field, net magnetic field in this model. So that was a sort of a big deal. He said quantum Hall effect needs time reversal symmetry to be broken. For those of you who are in undergraduate who have never seen this term, do not be afraid. It actually means motion reversal, everything going in the other direction. It's not really turning back time. But so Haldane wrote this comment. He said quantum Hall effect needs time reversal symmetry to be broken. And 20 years later, that actually launched another field of research. People who tried to prove Haldane wrong came up with models where time reversal symmetry is not broken, but spin Hall effect, another kind of Hall effect, is from, that's called topological illustrator. And even 3 years ago, people asked Haldane, will your model be experimentally realized? Will some experiment check your results? And he said, no, I wrote that paper to prove a point. That's a toy model. No one will be able to realize it. And now you can see the Nature paper, experimental realization of the topological Haldane model. So do not underestimate experimental researchers. You don't know how many different tools they have. Everything works out fine. It's okay. So it's a different way of looking at it. I should not underestimate theory here. But I mean, if your model is going to be realized in 3 years and you're sure that it's not going to be realized, maybe you don't know what experimentalists are doing.
Right.
Let me tell you about one more thing. Spin chains. So instead of putting all these magnets in 2D and 3D, what happens if I line them up? They can be a ferromagnet, they can like looking in the same direction, or they can be an antiferromagnet, where they can like being opposite to their neighbors. And it turns out, even from the first days of quantum mechanics, it was realized that quantum theory of antiferromagnets is hard. It's not easy. tell you one more thing about spin. And here all topological arguments come full circle. It turns out in quantum mechanics you cannot have any value of magnetization or angular momentum. Your magnetization can be either 1/2, 1/3, 2, either integer or half integer. And that's because a spin is exactly the same object as this electron moving in a sphere with a magnetic monopole at center. If you just put one monopole there, it's a spin and a half. If you put two monopoles, it's one. And what did Haldane do? The question was for spin chains. Are these antiferromagnetic spin chains, are they metallic-like so they can accept any amount of energy? Or is there a gap like insulators? You have to give at least a threshold energy to excite the system. And expectation was that all these chains were insulators. Haldane did a fantastic calculation, which showed if you have integer spin, they are insulators. If you have half integer spin, they are metals. And yesterday, really for half an hour, I was looking for a simple way to explain what Haldane did. And then I said, hey, Nobel Committee put out this explanation, maybe I'll copy from it. And what Nobel Committee did is put this nice figure, a spin pointing down at the center and slowly turning to point up. So it's a topological argument again. There is something called Riemann mapping. If you take a hedgehog on the sphere and map it onto a plane, you get a topological excitation. But to which plane am I mapping these things? It's the plane of x, one direction, the other direction is imaginary time. I have really no tools to explain this to an undergraduate audience. It's a fantastic calculation. When you take your graduate quantum mechanics course, go look up Haldane's papers, you will be able to hopefully understand this calculation. So there is the Haldane gap because of topology. Once again, and let me, I'm about to finish, let me tell you that the field is not dead. This is last week, I was in Brazil last week, talking in this conference. The name of the conference is Topological Effects in Ultra-Cold Atoms, and this conference was not organized after the Nobel Prize, it was organized in March, so that we could actually come. So in October, November. And here's the interesting thing. I actually presented a paper about the Haldane model. I presented what happens to the Haldane model if I make a topological change very quickly, extremely quickly. Okay. And we have a very concrete proposal. We said this whole conductivity after a sudden change will be 2/3 of E squared over H. And we're hoping that someone is going to experimentally confirm this. This was mostly done by my PhD student Nurinal and my collaborators Eric Miller and myself. Now, let me also make a prediction. I think within the next 10 years, there will be another Nobel Prize for topological things, especially about topological insulators. Because right now, there have been very good experiments on topological insulators. There is a lot of progress in theory, and there are even some applications of topological insulators right now. So maybe there will be another Nobel Prize in the next 10 years. I did put some names there, but I'm sure the Swedish Academy of Sciences will consider other people. But how about the future? So this is the present of the field. There's an idea called topological quantum computing. I hope the sense I actually gave you is that if I have something topological, it's well protected. It lives on for a long time. It's not disturbed by, you know, people walking around about temperature. It's It's a solid object. So can we actually use that topology to store and process quantum information? Can we make a topological quantum computer? That's not a rhetorical question. Right now it's mostly theoretical. But look at the people who are investing in topological quantum computing. Microsoft has a research station called Microsoft Station Q, which is Station Quantum, which is led not by a physicist, by a field medalist mathematician. Okay. Japanese Telecom Basic Research still has a big group led by physicists looking at topological quantum computation. And I think maybe in 10 years, computer programs would look like these nodes, like your grandmother needs. Okay, that's what a computer program looks like in topological quantum computing. So here are my conclusions. First of all, my personal idea is that Nobel Prizes are overblown. Okay, they're not the only important thing in physics. Nobel Prize is not that important. Unfortunately, Berezinski died, he never got the Nobel Prize. And even more unfortunately, maybe, I learned that Thales, the guy who got half the prize, the guy who did all these things, has Alzheimer's right now. So he doesn't understand that he gets the Nobel Prize. But their contribution lives on, their contribution is important. So concentrate on the physics. Over the years, I've met more than 10 Nobel laureates. I could say I'm on the first name basis with two of them. And none of them I know of did their work to get a Nobel Prize. They did their work because they love it, because they're genuinely interested. Second point is that physics is an experimental science. Doing experiments, making a connection to the experiments is important. Third point, this is especially true for undergraduates. When I was an undergraduate, I thought the biggest guys were the guys who closed the topic. Abi adam bir makale yazmış, bitirmiş. That doesn't happen. Okay. You actually write a good article that causes 100 more good questions to be asked. And finally, if I went back in time to 1960 and told physicists that topology, which at then was an obscure field of math, would be important in physics, physicists would have loved it. Right now it's very important. So mathematics, time and again, shows that it's the language of truth, language of nature. It's important to understand and use mathematics. That's all I want to talk about. I'll be happy to take any questions. I could not hear the question, so... Oh, I don't know. I mean, I'm very pessimistic about quantum computers. I don't think you'll see them in my lifetime. So, everyone is trying to do it, but there are many obstacles to be overcome, so I don't think we'll see anything beyond a 20 or 30 bit quantum computer. I don't think you have them allowed devices. That's it. Because entanglement is a very hard thing to protect. Even topological excitations have lifetimes. So I'm very pessimistic. I don't think you'll see a quantum computer.
Aren't you underestimating experimentalists?
I am underestimating experimentalists, exactly. For the engineers.
Other questions? Atakan, please.
So, this experimental model where we have the dipole and then the system, can you change it to three dimensions as well?
Okay, so in three dimensions, I think Bayram asked me why this happened. The entropic argument is not good enough. In 3D, what you can do is you can create a vertex ring. But entropy never becomes favorable for vertex rings to become dominant. Okay, so in 3D, those extensions are more important in lower dimensions. That's the general thing. No, in 3D, so putting a point in 3D has different entropy than putting a point in 2D. So, because face space is different. I'm putting a line, you're right, but then I can also orient that line. Okay, so that's why it's different. That's an excellent question. I mean, topological excitations in general relativity have been known for a long time. They are called cosmic strings and domain rules. But I don't think they have ever been observed. There are a lot of proposals that there are topological excitations in the universe. To my knowledge, there is no observation in the context of general relativity of these such objects. I even heard proposals modeling dark matter after such excitations. I would be out of my depth to answer that question. I don't know enough general relativity for that. But this idea, why is the electron quantized? Or why do we see the same charge over and over again? Even Lord Kelvin, of the Kelvin scale, he thought maybe there will be theories where we understand particles as some vertices of some ether. Okay, he was talking about the model of the ether. So this idea is prevalent. String theorists really would like to have each particle as some topological excitation. They would be very happy if they could write down a model like that. Yes? Okay, for a magnet, especially a vertex is somewhat easy. Okay, if you have a time-dependent magnetic field, you can stir up. But creating a hedgehog, so it's actually very hard. And I've seen some proposals for doing it. I actually am not aware of the experimental methods of how they create that. Sure. Sort of, yes. I mean that's the idea. So and there is a thing called spin ice, okay, where they have these. It's not a magnetic monopole, but exactly magnetic monopole-like looking excitations in the solid spin ice. It behaves more or less like you would expect a monopole to behave.
Other questions.
Are we able to control the vortex's entropy that have caused?
Okay, so in a way, yes. Okay, if what you can do is, as I said, what drives this transition is the entropy of the vertices. What you can do is you can actually limit the system size. Limiting the system size limits the phase space for these guys to populate. So you can change the Costanis Talos temperature by changing the area of the magnets. That's one way. Another way is you can do some patterning so that there are preferred places for vertices to get stuck to. And again, you can change the dynamics of this transition. So there's a large amount of literature, especially done on thin superconductors where there are these because of lattices. So in a way we can control the many properties, not only entropy.
Other questions? Comments? Alright. So maybe one last question.
How do you think the light at the photons actually the vortex or the
Okay, so for example, we are looking at systems in complex matter, right? So what is really important is the excitation vector scale. For example, if I create a vertex in a magnet, it also starts scattering of magnets, spin waves. Okay. The nice thing about topological excitations is that even if I do not know the details of these excitations, I know that those excitations are not going to kill my vertex because that takes a global change. That's why topological arguments are so powerful. But people certainly, at least theoretically, have looked at how a vertex interacts with a spin wave or in a superconductor, how it actually interacts with the magnetization or the parametric wave. So theoretically, there are methods. The nice thing is that those interactions do not actually change the physical picture at all.